Mark, to you all, I've been viewing the exciting dancing here, acrobatics from the side. I would very much, it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce Maria Melchior to you. She is a senior researcher at the Inserm. She's been working there since 2011 with an outstanding oeuvre and excellent scientific reputation. I think she fits in beautifully with ESCAP because she is one of the very few researchers to have an insight into different cultures, including those of Poland, France, England, United States. She was born and raised in Poland, and then as an adolescent moved to Paris, where she achieved her baccalaureate. With high honors in psychology as her major field, she received her Bachelor of Arts at Brandeis University in Massachusetts. She then obtained her Master of Science at Harvard School of Public Health, which was followed by attainment of the science doctorate in 2004 at the same school. In 2004, she also completed the doctorate in l'Université at the Faculté de Médecine Paris Sud in Social Epidemiology for her thesis titled Social Health Inequalities in France Results from the Gaysal Study. Maria has written many papers, including papers published, articles published in top-ranking journals, including Archives of General Psychiatry, American Journal of Psychiatry and Molecular Psychiatry. She has received several prizes, awards for her work, and she addresses one very crucial topic in child and adolescent psychiatry, in that she looks for the effects of low socioeconomic status on mental health of children and adolescents. Maria, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Dear Johannes, dear members of the organizing committee of ESCAP, thank you very much for inviting me to make a presentation here, and I'm especially honored to be the first speaker of this year's meeting. Before I start my presentation on social inequalities in children's and adolescents' mental health, I wanted to give a small disclaimer. Johannes mentioned that I trained in psychology, but I'm not a clinician, and I think it's important to start just by explaining to you my point of view on children and adolescents' mental health. So clinicians are inherently interested in individuals and in individual risk factors, in individual life histories, in individually targeted treatment as well. And of course, that's the best way to do things. And if one of my children was ever in need of mental health treatment, that's exactly what I would expect from a child psychiatrist that I would take him or her to. But what I do is work in epidemiology, and so we take a slightly different stand to try to understand mental health, and it's a very broad populational approach which aims to examine patterns of disorders, changes over time, and also the way in which these disorders can be associated with socioeconomic factors. And so it's a different view from the view you would take with an individual whom you're directly facing, but I'm going to try to convince you that this can also be of interest to the child psychiatrist. So let me first start with a little bit of history on research on social inequalities in health. And actually the first study I wanted to tell you about is not on mental health specifically, but it's documented as the first study to have ever quantified that people who live in poor neighborhoods have higher mortality rates than those who live in higher neighborhoods. And this is a study conducted by Louis-René Villarmé, was a French physician and researcher in the 18th and 19th century, and who is also quite famous for having conducted work on living and working conditions of working class individuals, and particularly children who were quite numerous in the developing factories at that time. And following his work, legal age at which children would be employed was actually risen, so that it passed from 8 to 10 years, so there were some direct policy implications of his research. With regard to mental health, the first known study to show that individuals who have low socioeconomic position have higher rates of mental health problems was conducted by an American physician by the name of Edward Jarvis, who was commissioned by the state of Massachusetts in 1855 to write a report which was called the Report on Insanity and Idiocy in Massachusetts. I think it's important just to say those words because that tells us how much we've moved on, obviously, with regard to perceptions of mental health since then. And his basic finding was that the pauper class furnishes, in ratio of its numbers, 64 times as many cases of insanity as the independent class. Now, of course, he based his research on records that were recorded in the hospitals. So what his data represent is not only the higher levels of mental health problems among individuals who were poor, but also the higher levels of hospitalization. And that's something that's really important to keep in mind. I want to talk about three different ways of looking at social inequalities with regard to mental health, and three different approaches which we often take in epidemiology. So the first approach is ecological. And as you see here on this slide, there's been a number of studies that have done this, namely look at characteristics of particular countries at a very global level and the rate of mental health problems, or here child well-being, which is a complex index of different types of items, including health and safety, educational well-being, peer and family relations, and behaviors and risks. And so as you see here on the slide, what you see here on the slide is that if you correlate the level of income inequality in different countries of the OECD with the average level of child well-being, what you find is that there is a linear association, which means that countries that have higher levels of income inequality, or those in which child well-being is the least favorable, so this is the case of the United States here, for example, at the very bottom. The UK, New Zealand, Israel also have relatively high levels of income inequality and poor levels of child well-being. And on the other end, countries such as Sweden, Finland, Norway, Denmark have relatively lower levels of income inequality and also higher levels of child well-being. So this is a very broad ecological view. Now, these very broad societal factors can also be put in relation to individually measured mental health. And this is what was done in this study conducted in the United States, where the researchers correlated the level of job loss at a state level. So among the 50 different states in the United States, there are different levels of economic development and different levels of unemployment, and particularly the economic downturn has been different across the past years. And so they were able to correlate the degree to which the number of jobs actually decreased in those different states with measures of adolescents' mental health, and here particularly suicide-related behaviors. And overall, what they found was that in states where job loss was higher, adolescents were more likely to report having suicidal ideas and also making suicide plans, and this was particularly true for girls. And actually what the slide also shows is that other aspects of state-level economy were also related to adolescents' suicidal behaviors, including the overall unemployment rate, for instance, and the percent of people who are living in poverty. Now, the third approach which we can take to try to relate socioeconomic factors to children's well-being is to look at the family's specific socioeconomic position and individually measured mental health and behavior. And there's a whole range of studies that have done this. There are actually so many studies that we now have systematic reviews which have already been able to put together the results of these different studies. One particular area which has been very much the focus of study is the relationship between socioeconomic position and children's risk of attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder. But there have also been other studies that looked at broader measures of children's emotional and behavioral well-being. And one of these reviews, published in Social Science and Medicine in 2013, was able to compile 55 different studies 52 of which, so the great majority, reported that children whose families have low socioeconomic position have higher levels of overall behavioral difficulties as measured by measures such as the strength and difficulties questionnaire, the child behavioral checklist, or the adolescent version of the child behavioral checklist. And overall, on average, what they found was that children growing up in these less advantaged families were 2 to 3 times more likely to experience mental health problems compared to those who grew up in more favorable conditions. Family income and parental education being the two indicators that were most strongly related to children's well-being. Another finding of this systematic review is that the relationship, the effects of family socioeconomic circumstances was stronger for younger children, for children under 12 years of age, and was especially pronounced when socioeconomic difficulties persisted over time, or when people experienced a decrease in their socioeconomic conditions. So for instance, they lost their job or their income decreased over time. And as far as this review was able to summarize, socioeconomic inequalities were stronger with regard to externalizing symptoms than with regard to anxiety, for instance, or other behaviors or other forms of children's difficulties. But here what's important to note is that overall there are more studies on socioeconomic factors and externalizing behaviors than on other forms of children's difficulties, including autism spectrum disorders. What I wanted to add perhaps to this systematic review is research results which are based on some of our research and also studies conducted in other settings, which show that one of the important socioeconomic indicators, which is now becoming known, is family food insecurity. You might think that this is quite a rare phenomenon. I mean, it doesn't mean that people actually go hungry, although that's the extreme end of food insecurity. But actually, in the general population in different countries, in the United States, but also in the UK, in France, in other countries in Europe, up to 10% of families say that for financial reasons, they have had to either cut down on the type of food that they can buy, they have had to cut down on balanced meals, for instance, or they have had to cut down on the portion sizes. And what we have found, actually this is using Canadian data from the Quebec Longitudinal Study of Child Development, is that children who were growing up in families that experienced food insecurity when they were in infancy were more than 2 times more likely than those who did not experience this situation to have high levels of symptoms of hyperactivity and inattention by age 8. And similar results were also observed in other studies. And the other figure here shows that among adolescents studied in the United States, there was actually an association between food insecurity and other forms of emotional and behavioral difficulties, including anxiety disorder, behavioral disorder, and substance disorder. So it seems that aspect, which of course is very strongly related to families' income, but not only. I mean, it's probably a particular type of financial difficulties that families are experiencing, is an important predictor of children's behavior. In young children, we tend to measure socioeconomic position by family standing. So as I mentioned, family income, for instance, or parental education. But in older children, in adolescents, it's actually possible to measure socioeconomic position by asking adolescents themselves. And so what you find when doing that is that actually adolescents' perceived socioeconomic standing, which is generally measured by asking them to rank themselves on the ladder from 0 to 10, for instance, where they're asked to say where they stand compared to other kids in the class or in their neighborhood. And so this type of measure is actually very accurate in predicting different forms of mental disorders. Here in this study, based on a sample of adolescents in the United States, mental disorders were actually measured using DSM-4 defined major depression, ADHD conduct disorder, and oppositional defiant disorder. And so it's actually quite interesting that besides objective measures, obviously adolescents' subjective perception of where they stand compared to their peers is relevant with regard to their mental health. And of course, this can include not only socioeconomic factors, but also how popular they are or how many friends they are. So there is a likelihood that some of that appreciation is related to their mental health, but still it does reflect an aspect of socioeconomic standing that is relative to peers, which is actually really important. Now, what do we know about time trends and social inequalities with regard to children's mental health? First of all, this is also a study conducted in the United States based on medical records. So, medical records of asthma, ADHD, and also autism spectrum disorders in the US National Survey of Children's Health. And first of all, what you find is that the prevalence of these three disorders has increased since 2003, between 2003 and 2012. And here, what the study shows are the prevalence levels in children whose families have from less than 100% of federal poverty level income. So in the United States, that's approximately $20,000 for a family of four. So these are children whose families earn 100% less than that, and these are children whose families earn more than 400% more than that. And so what you see is that with regard to asthma and ADHD, there are quite important socioeconomic differences in the prevalence of these disorders. And overall, they have somewhat probably increased over time. For autism spectrum disorders, there are no socioeconomic differences that are observed and no change over time except for the increase in prevalence, which of course can be due to a true increase in numbers or to an increase in, to a better identification of cases and better treatment access, or probably a little bit of both of these phenomena. So what you also see here is that high levels of ADHD, for instance, or asthma, but I'm more interested in mental health problems here. So high levels of ADHD are not concentrated among children who are growing up in the poorest families. They're actually quite spread out across the socioeconomic spectrum, and that's something that's referred to as the social gradient in mental health, which has been observed with regard to other disorders in children, but also in adults. And this is really important because the last part of my talk is going to be about interventions and the ways in which we can think about preventing socioeconomic inequalities in children's mental health. And obviously, if the problems are not entirely concentrated among children who are particularly poor, although they do have relatively high levels than those who are in intermediate income families or in high income families, it calls for different types of interventions than if the problems were entirely concentrated among the poorest families. Now you could say, well, in the United States there are lots of inequalities. What does it tell us about the situation in Europe? Actually, in Europe, or in the United Kingdom, but we know that this is also true in other countries, we observe similar socioeconomic gradients with regard to children's emotional and behavioral difficulties. And as you see here in the UK Millennium Cohort Study, you can see differences in children's behavior across the income gradient reported by their families as early as at age three. And this gradient tends to strengthen by the time children are 5 years and probably increases further while they grow up and are adolescent. An important issue for psychiatrists, I think, is also to try to figure out to what extent family socioeconomic position influences access to treatment. And what research says about this is that the situation is somewhat complex. So parents who are better educated overall are better at identifying their children's behavioral and emotional difficulties. So that's that also says that in some ways they're maybe better at acting upon trying to reduce those difficulties and taking their children, making sure that their children get proper treatment. But the relationship between family socioeconomic position and actual healthcare seeking is a little bit more complex and seems to vary in different countries. And obviously it's an area that's not researched enough. So to date, we can say that in the United States and Australia, for instance, where not all families have access to, or say access to healthcare is quite heterogeneous, family socioeconomic position is a strong determinant of actual access to treatment for children who have ADHD, for instance. Whereas in Europe and Canada, there are fewer inequalities with regard to access to treatment. But there's really a need to conduct more research on this, and particularly examine the type of treatment that children receive depending on their family's socioeconomic circumstances, and whether treatment adequacy, for instance, may vary, because that's something that's been observed in adults. So before talking about interventions, I just, because I'm an epidemiologist and we're very, very concerned about causality, of course, I just want to briefly talk about the extent to which we can really be sure that the extent to which we can ascertain that socioeconomic position causes mental health problems in children and adolescents. So there is a famous study that was conducted, that was published in 1992, which specifically aimed to tackle this question of causation versus selection, that is the influence of socioeconomic factors on mental health, and compare that to the effects of mental health on attained socioeconomic status among adults. This is a study based in Israel among army conscripts who are all screened for mental disorders. And the basic premise is that there are different groups of ethnic descent in Israel, and generally people of European descent tend to have higher educational attainment, whereas people of North African descent, anyway, this was back several decades ago, this may not be the case anymore, but that's the hypothesis in the study, that so people of North African descent tend to have lower educational level. And so by comparing these two different groups and the extent to which socioeconomic position, educational degree, attained educational degree was associated with different forms of mental health problems, the researchers wanted to test whether it was mental health problems influencing educational attainment or vice versa. And basically what they found, the study is a little bit complicated, but I strongly encourage you to read it. It was published in Science, which is really a big achievement for research of this type. So what they found was that the relationship between high school attainment, educational attainment, and schizophrenia was much stronger in army conscripts of European descent than of North African descent, which suggested that it was the psychological symptoms that probably had an effect on how well they did in school and their final educational attainment, whereas for depression there were no differences between the two different groups. So the answer to the question whether it is socioeconomic position influencing mental health or vice versa is complex, but overall the general assumption now is that the more severe forms of mental health problems can, of course, have direct impact on socioeconomic attainment, but socioeconomic circumstances in and of themselves also have an impact on symptom occurrence, persistence, and course over time. Now, if you try to link children's mental health problems to their family's socioeconomic position, the likelihood that it is the children's health that's influencing family status is lesser than when you're measuring individuals' own education or employment status. However, I do want to point to you that there's not that much research in this area, but the research that has been conducted shows that having a child with mental health problems does have an impact on family socioeconomic standing. This is, of course, mostly the case for persons who have children with severe mental illness, but even children with, even in families where parents have to address the needs of children with ADHD, which is, of course, relatively common, what you can see is that annual health expenses, annual absence days from work, and also the likelihood of terminating employment are somewhere in between the levels that are observed in families where no one has ADHD and those observed among people who themselves are diagnosed with ADHD and of course experience the highest levels of difficulties in regard to employment. And this is another study published recently in Science, which shows the long-term vicious circle that can be actually created And so this is the same data that I showed you looking at the degree of state-level unemployment and adolescent suicidal behaviors. And another analysis of this data showed that the mental health consequences that overall socioeconomic conditions can have on adolescents are then negatively impacting their economic and their academic attainment, which of course then feeds back into their own employment possibilities and possibilities to achieve to work full-time and achieve high employment once they're adult. What's really interesting about the study actually is that it's actually the idea was to test an economic hypothesis, or a hypothesis that's widely used by economists, which is that when there are high levels of unemployment, people actually tend to invest in education because they know that it's going to be more difficult to find low-skilled jobs. And I think apparently the reason why the study was also published in the renowned Science Journal is because what it actually shows is that because of the mental health effects of contextual unemployment levels, it's actually the opposite of what economists would expect. So the association, the relationship between socioeconomic circumstances and mental health obviously is quite complex. Okay, now having said all that, what can be done to decrease socioeconomic inequalities in children's mental health? The first thing I want to say about this is that there have been a lot of different interventions, a lot of different policies that are also implemented on a routine basis. But one thing that's not quite obvious is that improving mental health overall and decreasing inequalities with regard to mental health are two different objectives for health policy. And sometimes some policies which overall have effects on improving children's mental health can only be implemented by families that are the most wealthy and better educated, and actually as a downside tend to increase socioeconomic inequalities. So I know that it's a little bit of a complex message, but I think I'm going to try to show you specifically how this works out with regard to specific forms of interventions. So interventions that try to address mental health needs among children tend to be divided into two different types. There are interventions that are focused on youth from disadvantaged families, because you would think that sort of makes sense, that if those are the children who have the highest levels of problems, you want to really invest and focus on those children and their families. So they are both very targeted interventions and then more general programs that are trying to do this. One particular area where this has been experimented is early school education and early schooling. So a very famous intervention which has randomized children to attend early schooling prior to age six is the high school Berry Preschool Project, which has shown that overall, over the long term, children tend to attain better educational outcomes and also have better employment. The effects on mental health are a little bit more mixed. It's also what the evaluations of programs such as Sure Start and Head Start, which also try to get the maximum number of children in disadvantaged families to attend daycare prior to entering school, have also shown. They can be quite effective, but the long-term effects are not entirely clear now. Also, they only focus on very low-income children, so they don't entirely address the full social gradient that is observed with regard to mental health. There are other types of interventions that also tend to focus on disadvantaged families. Some can be conducted at a community level. That's the case of the Community That Care program, which was implemented in Australia, and which has shown positive effects on mental health awareness, for instance, on social ties within particular communities, and also on decreases in delinquent behavior or substance use among adolescents. So these can be quite effective, but again, they don't address the social gradient. And I want to just spend a couple of minutes describing another program which has been tested in the United States to try to improve the physical environment of disadvantaged families. And this is the Moving to Opportunity program. So this is a randomized trial that cost $70 million and that targeted over 4,000 families living in very deprived neighborhoods in Boston, Baltimore, Chicago, Los Angeles, and New York. And the families were randomized. There were three arms in the intervention. And in two of those arms, they were offered vouchers to move to a different neighborhood. One group was offered vouchers specifically to move to a neighborhood that was not poor. One group could choose the neighborhood that they moved to, and they were compared to a control group which was not offered any particular intervention. And again, this program was actually conducted by economists, and it has shown positive effects on educational attainment and employment level of families. But in terms of mental health, the results have been very mixed, and so I think it's important. It's interesting to try to think about what happened. Overall, what the results showed is that 10 to 15 years after the intervention, when participating children, so the whole families were randomized, what the researchers did is that they selected families with relatively young children. So they were approximately 16 years of age by the time this follow-up was conducted. And what you see here is that if you compare children who moved, so these are children in the control groups, and if you compare them to children who moved to any neighborhood or to those who moved to low poverty neighborhood, overall the effects in terms of mental health are relatively positive for girls, but for boys, there actually seemed to be a negative effect, so that in the families that moved, boys actually had higher levels of major depression, higher levels of post-traumatic stress disorder, and higher levels of conduct disorder, particularly those who moved to low poverty neighborhoods. In girls, there seem to be lower levels of depression and no effect on PTSD and conduct disorder. Why this happened? It's absolutely unclear. There's a lot of different studies have tried to tackle whether there were subgroup differences, for instance, whether the effect was different among younger versus older children, because one of the hypotheses was that the intervention was conducted too late, so when the children were already entering adolescence, and perhaps by that time, even moving to a better neighborhood and potentially going to better schools and having a more stable environment did not do anything really positive for their mental health. Maybe there were also differences across racial and ethnic groups. It's not clear, but I think what I wanted to show using this example is that just changing the environment, obviously, in this particular case, was not sufficient to improve mental health problems over the long term, even though we know that living in a poor neighborhood and suffering from detrimental physical conditions of the urban environment is a risk factor of children's mental health and behavioral problems. So life is complicated. I said that there are interventions that are focused specifically on low-income groups. There are also interventions that are universal, that are addressed to all children, and that may have beneficial effects to all, and that could perhaps also influence the degree of socioeconomic inequalities and mental health that are observed. So again, there are very different types of interventions. Some are based in schools. For instance, that's the example of the Mind Matters program, which was implemented in Australia and which aims to improve mental health awareness and cooperation within schools and has shown to be quite effective. Of course, there are interventions now that use new technologies and that are specifically targeted at adolescents. For instance, applications apps that can be used on cellular phones, such as Reach Out, which aims to give adolescents tools and strategies to use if they're experiencing mental health difficulties, these types of interventions are considered to be easier to use for adolescents than booklets, for instance, or other forms of information that can be disseminated. And then there are family interventions, the most famous of which is probably the Triple P Positive Parenting Program, which is universal intervention, but at the same time, it has different levels depending on a family's needs and depending on their skills. So in some ways, it's already adjusted to families' needs, and it includes a whole range of tips on how to develop positive parenting skills using media, tip sheets, parenting groups, and the interesting part of it is that the intervention can be tailored to different degrees of need. So all of these interventions seem to have positive effects on mental health. However, they're generally not evaluated in terms of their impact on socioeconomic disparities. So overall, one approach which has recently been proposed to address socioeconomic disparities with regard to different health issues is the approach of proportionate universalism, which was first described by the WHO Commission on the Social Determinants of Health, which took place between 2005 and 2008, and was chaired by Michael Mormon, who's a very famous British researcher in social inequalities in health. And the idea is that perhaps the best way to try to decrease socioeconomic inequalities is to implement universal policies that have benefits for all, but that have relatively greater benefits for families and children who are the most disadvantaged. So let me just give you an example of what those types of policies can mean. So for instance, early schooling is a good example because early schooling, for instance, in the way in which it is implemented in France, where all children go to preschool at the age of 3, it's free, and most children go to public schools. Recent estimates show that 97% of 3-year-olds therefore attend school. It also has positive effects on women's employment, but that's another issue. And so this type of universal policy benefits to all children without any sort of discrimination or potential stigmatization. And at the same time, what has been shown is that children who are growing up in the most disadvantaged families probably benefit particularly from this type of intervention because for them, the gap in terms of academic skills and school behavior is the greatest. And so they're particularly helped in terms of their later educational careers. In terms of mental health, to my knowledge, this policy has not been evaluated. But what this slide shows is that in public health science, there's a basic assumption, which is that most high-risk behaviors or risk factors and their prevalence depend on population averages. So they're assumed to be normally distributed, and that's probably an assumption that's quite reasonable with regard to emotional or behavioral difficulties in the whole population, perhaps even more severe types of problems such as psychotic symptoms or autism spectrum symptoms. So the idea is that in the population there's a distribution of symptom levels, and the higher the average, the higher the number of persons who have high-end difficulties, who have really high-risk behaviors. So what this means is that in order to decrease the number of children who experience high levels of difficulties, probably targeting those particular children, although they're in greatest need, is not really efficient. What you really want to do is decrease the population average and do so that the overall level of symptoms among children in the population is lower. I know this is a little bit abstract, but in terms of policy, this type of thinking really has important implications. So this is where universal policies such as early schooling, for instance, or different types of redistributive policies such as access to social housing or cash transfer programs or tax policy, which tend to redistribute income from individuals who are the richest to those who are the poorest, can really have beneficial effects at the overall population level, and probably by ricochet also decrease the number of persons with high-level symptoms and socioeconomic inequalities with regard to emotional or behavioral symptoms. Before I finish, I just wanted to mention another type of experiment, natural experiment this time, that has shown really positive effects in terms of mental health and social inequalities in this area. And this is a study that was conducted in the United States again, within the Great Smoky Mountain Study, which is a long-term longitudinal cohort study which follows a group of children and adolescents who were born in the Great Smoky Mountain area in the south of the United States. And part of this cohort study is composed of children who are Native American and who reside in a reserve for Native Americans. And what happened over the course of the study is that you probably know that Native Americans in the United States have special rights with regard to the possibility to open casinos. And so what happened is that during the course of the study, part of the families living in part of the study area benefited from the opening of a casino, and all the inhabitants of this area decided that the money would be redistributed to all the families living in that particular area. This was only for part of the children, and other children also participating in the study were not directly concerned by this casino opening. So what happened is that after the casino opened, all families' income level rose, and rose quite substantially. And of course, the researchers used this natural experiment to see whether this completely extraneous income increase, so the families didn't have to do anything particular to benefit from it. It was just dependent on where they lived. So the researchers then examined whether this increase in income had effects on children's emotional and behavioral symptoms. And what you see here is that what they observed is that the average number of symptoms of emotional and behavioral difficulties among children who were persistently poor, who were poor before the casino and after the casino because it was not open in their neighborhood, was persistently high. The symptom level among children who were never poor was persistently low, and among children whose families benefited from extra income from the casino opening, the number of symptoms over time actually decreased, and this translated into a lower rate of DSM-diagnosed mental disorders. Overall, the casino opening decreased the likelihood of having a DSM-4 diagnosed mental disorder by 50%, so that's actually quite a substantial decrease. This is just to say that there are different types of interventions that aim to decrease social inequalities and mental health in children. There are a lot of universal and social policies that are not specifically targeted at mental health, but that can have mental health benefits, and that should be probably evaluated in terms of their impact on inequalities in this area. But there are also very fundamental material factors, such as the family's income level, which probably need to be secure and stable and sufficient to make sure that children benefit from the best chances in life. So just to summarize, what research in this area shows is overall prevailing socioeconomic inequalities in child and adolescent mental health with some differences across different types of symptoms with stronger effects on externalizing symptoms. And as far as we know, probably not no effects on autism spectrum disorders. Parental education and income seem to be the strongest predictors of children's mental health, and adolescents' own perceptions are also quite relevant. It's important to keep in mind that there's this social gradient, so the highest number of cases of mental disorders in children and adolescents is actually not among the poorest children, but among those who are in the middle, who are in intermediate level groups. So in terms of public health policy, this is an important issue to take in mind, to keep in mind. And the underlying mechanisms are probably material, but also psychosocial, and the relative differences between children also contribute to their well-being. So I talked a little bit about social policies that influence families, employment, and income, and the need to evaluate universal interventions with regard to equity and mental health. And I just want to end by quoting Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who was born in Geneva, of course, who's a French philosopher of the 18th century. So really, it dates quite back, but I think what his thoughts on the origins of inequality were back then can still be inspiring for us today. So Rousseau distinguished natural versus moral and political inequality. For him, natural inequality was inequality based on individuals' strength, intelligence also, but other physical characteristics, which back then were thought to be entirely due to nature. We now know that it's more complicated than that. But he really distinguished those types of characteristics from moral and political inequality, which resulted from the way in which society is organized. And so he wrote that the extreme inequality in our ways of life, the excess of idleness among some and the excess of toil among others, the ease of stimulating and gratifying our appetites and our senses, the over-elaborate foods of the rich, which inflame and overwhelm them with indigestion, the bad food of the poor, which they often go without altogether, so that they overeat greedily when they have the opportunity, those late nights, excessive of all kinds, immoderate transports of every passion, fatigue, exhaustion of mind, the innumerable sorrows and anxieties that people in all classes suffer and by which the human soul is constantly tormented, these are all the fatal proofs that most of our ills are of our own making, which probably also means that we have the means to actually prevent them. Thank you very much.
Lunch will be served downstairs.